Hello dear students, welcome to our education. Today we are going to read class 7th history lesson 3, the Delhi Sultans. Important topics which we are going to cover in this lesson are internal and external expansion. Next is mosque and minaret, and next is administration. Let us start. Delhi first became the capital of a kingdom under the Tomar Rajputs, who then were defeated in the middle of the 12th century by the Chauhans. They were also known as Chahamanas, and they were of Ajmer. So you know the famous ruler of Chauhan dynasty was Prithviraj Chauhan. It was under the Tomar and Chauhan that Delhi became an important commercial center. Now what do you mean by commercial center? It means the place where lot of business activities are taking place. So many rich Jain traders or merchants or the businessmen, you can say them, they used to live in the city of Delhi. So it means Delhi was the city, a very rich city I can say, and they constructed many temples. And you know the construction of temple requires a lot of money, and that's why only rich people, they only can construct such temples. Coins were also minted in Delhi called Delhi Wall. The Delhi Sultans, they also built many cities in and around Delhi. Nowadays you can see Delhi is a very big place, but it was not this much big during the Delhi Sultanate period. Before Delhi Sultans, they came to Delhi, Delhi was not such a famous place. In fact, all other rulers, other kingdoms like Magadh, Ujjain, Banaras and Sindh, so these were much more famous than Delhi. So Delhi, hardly anybody used to know this place. But when these Delhi Sultan, they came and they make their capital at Delhi, then only the popularity of Delhi started rising. So Delhi Sultans, they also made lot of cities in and around Delhi. Delhi 1, as you can see, this Siri area, this is also known as Siri Fort nowadays, and you can see this Firoz Shah Kotla and Jahanpana. So these are the areas which were developed by Delhi Sultans. Now this is the chronology of rulers of Delhi. The earliest ruler of the Delhi was Anangpala. He belonged to Tomar dynasty. Thereafter Chauhan, he came and he defeated Tomar dynasty, and the famous ruler of Chauhan, as you know, Prithviraj Chauhan. Thereafter Turkish rulers, they came and they defeated Prithviraj Chauhan, and they started ruling on Delhi. And the famous ruler of these dynasties are Qutbuddin Aibak, Samsuddin Iltumish, Rajia Sultan, Ghiyasuddin Balban. Thereafter came the Sayyid dynasty, and the Khijr Khan was the famous ruler of this dynasty. Lodi dynasty, Bahlul Lodi. Thereafter Khalji dynasty, Jalaluddin Khalji, Alauddin Khalji. Tughlaq dynasty, Ghiyasuddin, Muhammad and Firoz Shah Tughlaq. So you can see Delhi Sultan, Delhi Sultanate is not the ruling of only one dynasty. In fact, is the combination of many dynasties. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, almost 6 dynasties, they have ruled on Delhi during the Delhi Sultanate period. Now let us see what Tawarikh is. Although inscriptions, you know what inscriptions are? Inscriptions are writings on the hard surfaces, like on stones, on metals. And coins and architecture means old building, palaces, temples, forts, palaces which are being built by the earlier people. These three are the important source of history. They provide a lot of information, and especially valuable are histories. Now what histories are? Histories are known as tarikh. Tarikh is singular, and when we say tawarikh, it means plural. And these tarikh or these tawarikh, they were written in Persian language, and the meaning of tawarikh was histories, means somebody's story. So you can see this handwriting, this is as good as the typewriter's handwriting, how accurate and how straight in the line. So this is one of the sample of the tawarikh. We cannot understand this language because it is Persian language. एंड यू नो पर्शियन वॉज द ऑफिशियल लैंग्वेज ऑफ दिल्ली सुल्तान्स. पर्सिया इज़ द ओल्ड नेम फॉर ईरान. नाउअडेज पर्सिया इज नोन एज ईरान. सो इट मीन्स ऑल द सुल्तान दे हैड कम फ्रॉम ईदर ईरान और द नियर बाई एरियाज ऑफ ईरान. तवारिक मेकिंग. वट वॉज द प्रोसेस ऑफ मेकिंग तवारिक. फर्स्ट थिंग वॉज टू प्रिपेयर द पेपर. सो ही इज़ फ्लैटनिंग वन पेपर. देर आफ्टर स्क्राइब्स दे यूज टू राइट डाउन द हिस्ट्री और द कंटेंट ऑन दीज पेपर्स. देर आफ्टर मेल्टिंग गोल्ड टू हाईलाइट. सपोज देर इज सम इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग रिटन ऑन दीज पेपर. सपोज सम रूलर्स नेम और द वॉर ही हैज़ वॉन. सो दोज थिंग्स नाउअडेज वट वी डू टू हाईलाइट सम पोर्शन इन द नोटबुक. वी जस्ट यूज हाईलाइटर विच इज़ अवेलेबल इन द स्टेशनरी शॉप. बट दैट टाइम देर वॉज नो हाईलाइट. सो सी द रॉयल थिंग दे यूज टू हाईलाइट इट विद द गोल्ड. सो वट एवर इम्पॉर्टेंट कंटेंट और द नेम वॉज मैंशनड इन दीज बुक्स दे वर हाईलाइटेड विथ गोल्ड. एंड द फोर्थ एंड द लास्ट स्टेज वॉज टू प्रिपेयर द बाइंडिंग. वंस दीज ऑल पेजेस आर रिटन देन दिस पर्सन ही यूज टू बाइंड ऑल दीज पेजेस टूगेदर. वट बाइंडिंग इज. बाइंडिंग इज कंबाइनिंग. सो ही यूज टू कंबाइन ऑल दीज पेपर एंड देन फाइनली यूज टू मेक इट वन बुक. द ऑथर्स ऑफ तवारिक्स वेर वेरी लर्नेड मैन. लर्नेड मैन मीन्स वेरी एजुकेटेड एंड स्कॉलर पीपल. दे रिकाउंटेड इवेंट्स. दे रिमेंबर्ड ऑल द इवेंट्स थ्रू देयर ओन एक्सपीरियंसेस और समटाइम फ्रॉम द सोल्जर्स हु यूज टू गो टू द वॉर एंड समटाइम फ्रॉम द पीपल इन एंड अराउंड द सिटी. एंड अपार्ट फ्रॉम राइटिंग तवारिक दे ऑल्सो एडवाइज रूलर्स how to maintain governance in your territory and emphasizing the importance of just rule. What do you mean by just rule? Means the rule of law, not to do injustice with any person in the territory. So this was also like Tawarikh writing people, they also used to give good advices to the rulers. So all the Tawarikh writing people, they either were secretaries or they were administrators. Sometimes they were poets and sometimes they were courtiers. Courtiers means the people who work as officer inside the courts. So as you can see, they all were learned and they all were experienced and educated persons. The circle of justice. Fakhre Mudabbir, he was also a person who had written one Tawarikh. So what he had written in his Tawarikh, which was written in 13th century, he has written, a king cannot survive without soldiers. A king require a large army with lot of soldiers. And all the soldiers, they cannot live without salaries. Not even a single soldier will work or fight for his ruler without salary, because salaries come from the revenue collected from peasants. And all this salary, where do we get this salary from? This salary comes from the tax, and this tax is collected from the peasants. Who are peasants? Peasants are the farmers or the people who live in the villages or do other types of trades also. But peasants can pay revenue, means tax, only when they are prosperous and happy, when they have sufficient amount of money and when they are happy, and when they will become happy when king promotes justice and honest governance. Means when king will look after their needs, king will take care of everybody, then only peasant or the villager will be happy. The author of Tawarikhs, they lived in cities, mainly Delhi, and they had never been to villages. They often wrote their histories for sultans in the hope of rich reward. So whenever they used to complete a tawarikh and hand it over to the sultan used to give them a big amount of money or reward. So you cannot rely on this tawarikh 100%, because sometime what used to happen, these tawarikh writing people, they must have written some false thing about their rulers to just make them happy. These authors, they also advise rulers on the need to preserve an ideal social order based on birthright and gender distinctions. Their ideas, although were not shared by everybody. Now, what they used to advise the ruler, one was birthright and other was gender distinction. Now, what is birthright? They used to keep telling the rulers that only the people of royal family or the people of the royal dynasty, they only are supposed to rule the country. And next is gender distinctions, means only the male members of the royal family, they are supposed to rule the country. Although their ideas were not liked by all the rulers, and sometimes some rulers did not follow their ideas. In 1236, Sultan's Iltutmish daughter Rajia, she became Sultan. Now see, she is the first woman Muslim ruler of the country. And the chronicler of the age, his name was Minaj-e-Siraj. He has also written lot of tawariks. So he recognized what he has written in his book, that she was more able and qualified than all her brothers. It means Sultan Iltutmish was having lot of sons also. But all the sons, they were not as qualified as Rajia Sultan. So, but still, even she was so talented and qualified, but Minaj-e-Siraj, he did not like her to become a sultan, and he was also not comfortable at having a queen as a ruler, nor were the nobles happy at her attempts to rule independently. Now, who are nobles? Nobles means the people or the ministers who are working inside the court or in the palace. So finally, she was removed from the throne in 1240. So it means, when did she sit on the throne? In 36, and she was removed in 1240. It means she ruled only for 4 years. Now, what Minaj-e-Siraj thought about Rajia? Minaj-e-Siraj thought that the queen's rule went against the ideal social order created by God, in which women were supposed to be subordinate to men. What he thought? As you can see, Minaj-e-Siraj, he was such a learned man, he was an educated man, but in spite of this, he was doing discrimination with the women. And he said that a queen cannot rule a country because it is against the God's wish, because God has said that only male can rule a country. And the work of the women is to only assist a male or to subordinate the male. The sultans seldom control the hinterlands of the cities. Next, our topic is expansion of Delhi Sultanate. Now, what is hinterland? Hinterlands are the areas which are adjacent. Adjacent means nearby to a city or port that supply it with goods and services. Goods means material, metal, or the things which come from other countries, or which is supplied from our country to other countries, and sometime it is brought from other country to our country. Okay, so sultans, they could not control these hinterlands, so they focused only inside the Delhi. But Delhi is at the center of India, as you know, and there are no ports in Delhi. So whatever goods it used to come at port area only, and port was either at Gujarat, Mumbai, or towards the eastern side in Bengal. So one has to travel from Delhi to Bengal or Delhi to Gujarat to get the goods. And while bringing goods inside Delhi, lot of other rulers, they also used to ask the tax from the businessmen or the traders. Controlling garrison town in distant land and Sindh from Delhi was extremely difficult. Now you can see this area is Delhi and this is Sindh and this is Bengal. So the both area from where the goods used to come, controlling these two areas while sitting in Delhi was such a difficult task, just because of the distance. There's a lot of distance between these two areas, because that time there were no facility of planes or the trains or the private vehicles. One has to ride the horse or go on their feet to reach these areas. And that's why sometime, due to rebellion, due to war, and sometime even due to bad weathers, they could not control these two areas. And you know what Garrison Town is? Garrison Town is a place where the ruler, he installs his soldiers or his commanders to look after the city and to keep an eye on the enemy approaching towards their town. Delhi's authority was also challenged by Mongol invasions from Afghanistan and by governors who reveled at any sign of the Sultan's weakness. Now, as you can see, this is India and this whole territory is being captured and ruled by Mongolian ruler Genghis Khan. So he was also a threat for the Delhi Sultans, because every now and then he used to send his army to Delhi and loot the lot of jewelry and money from India. Okay, so the army of Genghis Khan, it was such a big and strong army that a small territory of Delhi, it cannot protect it from the attack of these Mongolian army. And second thing, what was causing problem to the Delhi Sultan was the rebellion of the governor. Suppose the other territories which Delhi Sultans, they have already captured, they are being governed, they are being given under the rule of governors. But as soon as the Sultan is weak, what the governors, they used to do, they declared their territory independent and declared themselves as the ruler of those territories. Expansion of Delhi Sultanate. Expansion means increasing the territory of the Delhi. Its consolidation occurred during the reign of Ghiyasuddin Balban and further expansion under Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq. So this was the first ruler who had thought about increasing his territory, and thereafter the same process was also followed by Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq. Now they thought that why should we only remain inside this Delhi area, we should also try to capture other territories also, so that we can enhance our territory, so that we can make our army strong. So as you can see earlier, this much was the territory which Delhi Sultans were having. Thereafter, when the expansion began, when they started increasing their territory, this much area, this came under Delhi Sultanate. The first set of campaigns along the internal frontier. Now there are two types of campaigning started by Delhi Sultan. First was internal campaigning and the second was external campaigning. And what is internal campaigning? Internal campaigning means to start something inside only, first doing it from the inside. And what is internal frontier? Let us see. Sultan aimed at clearing the forest of Ganga, Yamuna, Doab. You know, there is a river Yamuna which flows through Delhi, and there is a river Ganga which flows through Uttar Pradesh. So the area between Ganga and Yamuna, it is known as Doab, and it is very fertile area. So whosoever ruler captures this area, he becomes very prosperous and very rich. So Sultan, they thought of clearing all these forests so that this forest area can be brought under the agricultural land, because the forest was not giving them any revenue, it was just useless. So they started clearing all these forest area, and all the people who were living inside this forest, they were known as hunter gatherers, because they were not having their one fixed resident at one place. They used to do hunting inside these forest and thereafter move to some other place. And when they were expelled means they were ousted, they were thrown out of these forest, then they had nothing to eat, nothing to do. Finally they started doing agriculture activities on these cleared area, and they became farmers. These lands were given to peasants. Now, what do you mean by peasants? I told you again before also, peasants means farmer. So, all this cleared area, now you can see how beautifully it has been converted into fields, right? So, now fields are very beneficial because you can grow a lot of crops in that area, and by selling the crop, you can pay tax to the ruler. And thereafter, agriculture was encouraged. New fortresses means fort is a place where soldiers or the army is placed so that they can check and they can protect their territory. And garrison towns were also built. Means something was done that was out of the Delhi. Military expeditions into southern India started during the reign of Alauddin Khilji. As you can see, this is Delhi area, and he had sent his army towards this south area to capture all these areas. Okay, and when they used to defeat the armies of these areas, while coming back, they used to bring lot of horses, elephants, slaves, and precious metals from the southern part of the India, which territories they had defeated. So this way also they had collected lot of wealth. Wealth means lot of money. By the end of the Muhammad Tughlaq's reign, 150 years after somewhat humble beginnings, the army of the Delhi Sultanate had marched across a large part of the subcontinent. Means Muhammad Tughlaq was also a great ruler who had done a lot contribution for expanding the Delhi area or the rule of Delhi. So he had almost brought a large part of India into his territory. They had defeated rival armies and their cities. Siege means they have blocked many cities. The Sultanate collected tax from the peasantries and dispensed justice in its realm. So it was not that he was only cruel, he was only after capturing others' land. He also ensured that all the people, all the peasants, whosoever living under his territory, should be happy and should get the proper justice. Now let us talk about mosque and minaret. Mosque and minaret, they were also built during the last decade of the 12th century. As you know, whosoever is the ruler and whatever religion they follow, they try to expand their religion, they try to propagate their religion, they try to advertise their religion. So all these rulers, they were the Muslim in religion. So they had started making mosque to offer the prayers. First city built by the Delhi Sultans, described in the chronicles as Delhi e Kunha, the old city. The old Delhi was known as Delhi e Kunha in the book. The mosque was enlarged by Iltutmish and Alauddin Khilji. Now, what is minaret? Minaret is a tall tower attached or adjacent to the mosque. Wherever there are mosques, you will always find four minarets on the four direction of that mosque. And why it is built? It is designed so the call of prayer issued from mosque 5 times a day can be heard loud and clear throughout a town or city. In earlier times, when there were no loudspeaker, people used to climb on these minar and they used to call the prayer so loudly that all the people who are living in the city, they can hear the namaz 5 times a day. This is Qutub Minar, which is also near one mosque in New Delhi, and it was built by Qutubuddin Aibak. You can see inscription and the writings of Quran, teachings of Quran, they are engraved on these Qutub Minar walls. How beautifully this has been inscribed, as you can see in this picture. Mosque. The mosque was enlarged by Iltutmish and Alauddin Khilji. A mosque is called a masjid in Arabic. Mosque is an English word and it is known as masjid in Arabic. Literally, it is a place where a Muslim prostrates in reverence to Allah. This is Begumpuri Mosque and it was built by Muhammad bin Tughlaq. The Delhi Sultans built several mosques in cities all over the subcontinent also. It's not they only built in Delhi. In and around the areas of Delhi, in other states also, they built many mosques. These demonstrated their claims to be the protector of Islam and Muslim. Mosque also helped to create the sense of community of believers because Muslim came from a variety of background. So when all short of Muslims, see there are also various division of Muslim community, like we have lot of division in Hindu religion also. Some people they follow Lord Shiva, some people they follow Lord Vishnu. Similarly in Muslim community also there are variety of groups. And these mosques were built so that all the groups of the Muslim community, they can gather over here, they can offer prayers or namaz, they can read namaz and bring a sense of belongingness while gathering over here. Administration and consolidation under the Khiljis and Tughlaqs. Now let us talk about administration, means how they used to rule their country, rule their territory. Iltutmish, he was one of the ruler of Delhi Sultans. He favored their special slaves. You know, Iltutmish, he himself was a slave. Slave is a person who is brought from some defeated territory, or sometimes they are brought by paying lot of money to their master. So they do all the work for their master. So he was so favorite of his master. Finally, his master made him a ruler of the Delhi. He also purchased many special slaves for military services and they were known as Bandagan in Persian. They were carefully trained to man some of the most very high position, like they were made governors and sometimes they were made the mansabdars of special territories, sometimes they were made ministers, commanders and general of the army also. Because he used to believe them on a lot. The Khiljis and Tughlaqs also raised people of humble birth. Humble birth means people from the normal families, not from the royal families, who were often their clients to high political position. So the position of ministers, chief ministers or governors or commander, it was given to the people who were from the normal families, normal backgrounds. They were appointed as generals and governors. However, this also introduced an element of political instability. Instability means when the princes, they heard that they were not made governor, so what they used to do, they became angry with their father and they started doing rebel against their father, and this way this also brought instability. Instability means suppose one king has ruled only for 2-3 years, thereafter some other person he's trying to become the ruler. And this way, when lot of rulers change within a short span of time, that is known as instability. Slaves and clients. The person slaves, you know, which are bought with the money. They were very loyal to their masters. And who are their masters? Rulers are their masters and patrons. But not to their heirs. Heirs means the successor or the children of the rulers. So they used to like their master but not their children. New Sultan had their own servants. So their children, they had kept their own servants and they were not comfortable with the servants of their father. New Sultan had their own servants. Author of Persian Tawarikh criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing the low and base born to high offices. As we read before also that all the people who used to write Tawarikh, they also advise their rulers that only the people of high caste or high birth or the royal family only should be need to be appointed as governors or the generals. But these rulers, they did not listen to their advice and they made such low caste people or the people from the low birth or the low families, or sometimes the slaves also, on the they position them on the higher post. The Khiljis and Tughlaq monarchs appointed military commanders as governor of territories. Now see, one person who is already a military commander, he also has been given the post of governor of a territory, because earlier I told you it was very difficult for a ruler to look after all the territories of his province. So these governors, they used to look after those provinces, and these lands were called iktas, and their holder was called iktidar or muktis. So these governors were given the villages, or more than one villages sometime. So these villages were known as ikta, because these governors, they used to collect taxes from those iktas. The duties of the mukti was to lead military campaigns and maintain law and order in their iktas. Iktas mean their areas or the group of villages, and in exchange for their military services, the muktis collected the revenue from their assignments as salary. Now their assignment is their villages. They used to collect taxes from the peasants, and complete tax they used to hand over to the ruler. But they also required to pay to their soldiers, so some portion of the revenue or the tax they used to keep it with them to pay salaries of their soldiers, and rest of the tax they used to hand over to the rulers. Accountants were appointed by the state to check the amount of revenue collected by the muktis. Now it was not like that muktis wish is whatever he want to collect, he can collect. It was not like that. To look after what he is collecting, the ruler also had appointed accountants who used to keep an eye on the muktidar or the iktidar. Care was taken that the mukti collected only the taxes prescribed by the ruler. Suppose ruler has told to collect 15 rupees from a family, right? But governor or the military commander, he is collecting 25 rupees from that family. It means he is collecting 10 rupees extra from that family, which is wrong. So this is what being checked by these accountant, and they also ensure, they also check that how much strength of the soldiers he is keeping in his army. Suppose king has ordered him to keep only 100 soldiers in his troop or in his army, but the governor is keeping 200 soldiers in his army, so that is also reported to the ruler. There were three types of taxes. First tax was on cultivation, which was known as kharaj, and its tax was about 50% of the peasant's produce. It is so high, means if he is earning 100 rupees per year, then he has to hand over 50 rupees to the ruler. Such a high tax. Thank God we are not living in those times. Second tax was on cattle, and third tax was on houses. The more magnificent building you have made for yourself, the more money you will have to pay to the ruler also. Ibn Battuta, a 14th century traveler from Morocco. Morocco is a country in African continent. He had come to India, and what he had written in his book, that chieftains sometimes fortified themselves in mountains. Chieftain means the people who used to take care of the villages, and when sometimes they don't want to listen to the rulers, then how they used to take care of the ruler's army? By hiding themselves in the fortified mountains. These mountains were very rocky, sometimes uneven, and sometimes rugged places, and sometimes they used to hid inside these bamboo groups so that they were not seen by the ruler's army. Mongol attacks on the Delhi Sultanate increased during the reign of Alauddin Khilji and in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq's rule. This forced the two rulers to mobilize a large standing army in Delhi. So to stop the invasion, to stop the attack of Mongol army, these two rulers, they also enhanced and increased the number of soldiers in their army. The Sayyid and Lodi dynasties, they ruled from Delhi and Agra until 1526. By then, Jaunpur, Bengal, Malwa, Gujarat, Rajasthan and the entire South India had independent rulers. Means these were the areas which were not under the Delhi Sultanate, who established flourishing states and prosperous capitals. Sher Shah Sur, who ruled from 1542-1545, only for 5 years, he started his career as the manager of a small territory for his uncle in Bihar, and eventually he challenged and defeated the Mughal Emperor Humayun also. See, such a big and strong army he had defeated. Sher Shah captured Delhi and established his own dynasty. Although the Sur dynasty, he belonged to Sher Shah Suri dynasty, so Sur is his dynasty name, and he ruled for 15 years from 1542-1555. It introduced an administration that borrowed elements from Alauddin Khilji, and he had taken how to administer the territory well. He learned it from the Alauddin Khilji and made it more efficient with some of his own experiments. Sher Shah's administration became the model followed by the great emperor Akbar. So Akbar also followed the good administration model of Sher Shah Suri. These are some of the important questions, and all the answers are in this video only. So you can give the answers, you can find the answers, you can make the answers on your own.